from North Carolina, and you've come all the way to downtown Newtonville, New Jersey, to talk about quilts and to talk about your wonderful exhibit you put together for us. I was really, really impressed when I was first introduced to you because of the work that you do, working with your hand, doing hand-quilted work. It's just a thing that doesn't happen too much today. A lot of the quilts are being made today. They're done with old Singer machines and now new Brother Singing machines, so to say. But your work is truly, truly great. I just wanted you to take one moment, if you would, and just talk about this particular quilt in this series and what inspired you to put this quilt in your exhibit.
This piece, Prayers Cast on Water, started off actually as just a a memento or something to hang in my own house that reminded me every day of the week of positive and to bring positive energy to me and to my home. And once I finished a piece, it was about 12 inches by 16. And I realized I hadn't gotten enough of it. I wanted to do more. So I did another one, a slightly bigger one. And that wasn't enough. So that is when I did this piece. This is the largest piece in the series that I did. And I was inspired to do it because once I did it for myself, and I couldn't quite get enough of it. It was something that I wanted to do another and another. So in order to make it more inclusive, I researched the different religions that I knew, the five great religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, Judaism, and Christianity. And I found in each one of those religious traditions, there is some mention or some ritual around prayers on water, prayers cast on water, cast your prayers on water. In the Islamic tradition, there's actually a day in the calendar year that Muslims actually cast their prayers in water. In the Jewish tradition, there is a time in the new year when they actually cast bread on water, meaning bringing good to you. So I thought this is something that I can do, and I looked at it in a larger context of just the world in a crisis and people wanting to do more positive things. People are going back to an organic way of living. People want more positive things, gemstones, color therapy is on the rise again, all of these modalities. So I thought this goes in quite well, and the community can participate in this piece. It's interactive. You put your prayer in. When it's full, you can see from the pieces, the openings that I created in this piece, a person can actually write their prayers on it. And once it's all full, they're carefully moved out. I've never read any of them. I handle them very carefully. And I put them in a paper bag with a stone so they're weighted down, and I cast them into the Eno River, which is a river in North Carolina, Durham, where I'm from. So everybody's prayer that is put in here is handled carefully. And it just garnered a feeling of inclusive to me. It was a part of the spiritual community that everybody can participate in. And not once have I had anyone that didn't grasp the idea and want to be a part of it. So that's how Prayers Cast on Water came to be.
Prem, I'm writing my special prayer to be cast on water, and hopefully my prayers will be answered because I believe in the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, and therefore I know that things will just get better and better and better and better.
And it brings the community together, all of the religious community comes together to write their prayers, because we're all praying for something. We all want to garner positive energy to ourselves and our families and friends. And sometimes we just want to write something or say something that's so incredibly personal. We can even have smaller ones that you can have in your home, say one with seven openings, and you can have a prayer for every day of the week. When you feel, or even poetry. Some people have inserted their poetry. They've inserted things that they hope for people. Communities have, religious communities have actually worked on large pieces like this together for a particular thing that the community itself is trying to bring about. So it's been very powerful.
Well, would you be able to continue to make more of these in different sizes?
Yes.
And that's so very, very important, because a lot of people came in and said, what happens if I buy that? Will that be the end of the prayers? And I'm saying, I would hope not, that Karima would have the opportunity to remake and to re-sew these by her lovely hands.
Well, I really want that to happen. What I'd really like to see is to have several people from several communities actually make a panel, given the dimension. We want so many inches of trees, we want so many inches of water, and so many inches of earth. And then we could put all of these panels together and have this incredibly long quilt that could actually
circle the globe eventually.
Precisely. I mean, it could be. A community might want to work on it, but I don't think I will ever not make these. They're great for gifts. They're great for purchases, for people who want smaller pieces. And whoever runs out of prayers, no one ever
runs
out of
prayers. If they do, they can pray for me.
Exactly.
And our projects we have.
They never run out of prayers and wanting good for each other and for people. So I think this is a series that will continue for a long, long time.
Beautiful.
This piece is called The Middle Passage. I was asked to do a piece on abuse in humanity for the museum at the University of Michigan in Lansing. And this is my interpretation of the Middle Passage. I imagined, of course, the blue of the water, and these beautiful, beautiful circles of all the people that were taken from their continent and enslaved and brought to the Americas. And for all of these circles, this represents a person, a tribe, a family. The circles, you can see some of them are openings. That's symbolic of those people who didn't make the journey because of either illness and died, or simply couldn't cope with the constrictions that faced them, and they didn't survive this incredible ordeal. Again, there's the goldenrod yellow silk. But I abstracted the middle passage because I wanted the imagination to come from the look-oner, the observer of this piece, the person that was interacting with it. I wanted them to feel from just these circles the intense constriction that these people must have felt. Instead of giving them an image of what it would be like, I wanted them to play with the image of what they could imagine hundreds and hundreds of people thrown together in a bottom of a boat for days on end. Little food, no water, just the human condition interacting with the most banal of conditions. So that's why I abstracted that way. You can see some red. It must have been at times bloody. Then you see some darker circles for just the mental state that these people must have experienced. And then you see a combination of many things. All of this is to combine the physical torment, the mental anguish, and just death itself, birth. What if there were women who were actually pregnant and gave birth on these journeys? So it's all of those, all of the above, just the human condition constricted to the point of a place that we can't even imagine. We can't imagine it. I would not want to try to instill an image in a person's mind, because it's so intense they would have to be with it themselves. They would have to sit in their own council with this one.
Karima's piece once again. If you look back, you can actually see the universe as she envisions the universe. I actually see people I see faces, I see hats, I see pyramids, I see a lot of things happening here in the universe. Her concept for putting things together is fantastic. Once again, look at those stitches there. That's not by a sewing machine, that's by hand. Just thousands and thousands of stitches. And her fabrics she's chosen are all hand-dyed fabrics. She chooses her fabrics from all over the world and puts them together. Not only does she does quilts and wall tapestry, she does jewelry. These are some of her antique quilts. And this quilt here has got to be made back in the early 1910, 1920, some of that range. But the flying geese are there at that point.
Oh, yeah.
And what fascinates me about this particular quilt, look at the orange color she found. Mm-hmm. Couldn't have it up to finish, so they did orange and put the turquoise in there. Just truly, truly, truly amazing. Don't you love it? And these patterns here, look at these patterns. Can't wait to hang it. Can't wait to hang it. Truly, truly amazing. And here you're going to see her jewelry right here. She makes jewelry from her travels around the world. She's able to take the wonderful stones. You can see mother pearl, you see the kiwi shell, and all the different types of materials she works with. Not with leather, not with steel or any of this thing, but her works are just wonderful.
So a friend who is an artist in Atlanta, and I gave each other a challenge of doing a family portrait. Doing an image of ourselves, a self-portrait, I'm sorry. And this is what I came up with. The fabric itself was tie-dyed, so it had a lot of texture to it, so I didn't have to add any other features. The fabric spoke for itself. And I just love this idea of hair coming off the piece itself. And it just, actually, it reminded me of my own hair and my family's hair. So that was very nice. And I added the buttons and the mirrors and all for texture. But I thought, this is a nice self-image. The fabric spoke for itself. It's really the fabric that does it. So that's my self-portrait. This piece, I think it's by far one of my favorite pieces. It's called the Alaska Highway, and it's a dedication to the African American engineers who had never been allowed to work as engineers in the military until the bombing of Pearl Harbor. And once the Pearl Harbor was bombed, all of the engineers were needed to build a highway. So it would be a passageway for jets to land and take off and that sort of thing. And the African Americans who worked on it were unique in that they were trained engineers. They had never worked as engineers in the military. And when they were called to action, they were given a point from which to meet their counterparts. And these men, of course, as the constricted time in history was, were not given proper tools from which to work. I read an article in Legacy magazine, and it got everything rolling for me. Once I read the article, I just saw the coldness. I saw the desolation and the coldness and the beauty of extreme cold. And I knew I wanted to honor these men by doing something for them. And I dyed this piece of fabric in these different shades of blue because it reminded me of extreme cold. So you can see here, if you look at ice, if you look at a large mass of ice like an iceberg, it's not really clear because it's reflected from the sky. So that's what this color represents. Now the bits of yellow, all of these yellow pieces of silk are my signature. Everything that I make, I add a little bit of goldenrod yellow silk. But since I have done this piece, people think it reflects sun, the sun coming through and hope. And I've kind of borrowed that as a part of the piece itself. But that's it, this is just my signature. Yellow, but it does remind you of sunshine and a very desolate, cold climate. for people who were not used to those intense temperatures of coldness.
This lady's name is Fannie Lee Cheney. Fannie Lee Cheney is the mother of a gentleman by the name of James Cheney. If anybody remembers the movie Mississippi Burning, but more so than Mississippi Burning, her son James was assassinated along with these other two boys in the early 1960s. And when he was assassinated, his mother became very upset. She's from a line of long quilters, five generations of quilters. It's here. Take a look at her work here. This is just incredible work, all hand stitched. Mrs. Cheney passed in year 2012. And before she passed, she had a caseworker in Willingboro, New Jersey. And her caseworker then donated these quilts to her caseworker. She found out about our quilt exhibit here at the museum, and she called us up and asked, can we put on exhibit her two quilts? And we said yes. Not only does she have the quilts, but the other ephemera to document that these are her quilts, here is Mrs. Cheney right here. Those are her son and the other two boys that were assassinated. What a great piece of history. And to have this in with your work as quilters, as well as Karima and the other quilters, just fascinates me. It just ties the old with the new, with the struggle that the folks have gone through. And over here, this is another exciting piece here. This is called a wedding ring. Some of you quilters understand it, right? This piece is on loan to us by a gentleman by the name of Kenny Davis. Ken Davis is out of Atlantic City. You might know his brother Mike. Or Bootsy or the rest of them. This is Kenny Davis's quilt. And he's been kind enough to put on the loan seven antique quilts and five quilts and two Afghans. But the work you see in the wedding ring is truly amazing. I mean, this is hand-stitched work. I mean, look, we don't want you to touch it, but but you can just, as quilters, you can appreciate what Now, the wedding ring symbolizes something very, very important to African people. It tells the story of a man marrying a woman and how they're encircled. See all they're encircled together? And in Africa, in the old country before we came here, they only had one ring. Today they use two rings. Male gets one and the female gets one. But this is the continuous slavery, the chain, the wedding, the family. You just feel the energy that comes out of one of these quilts. It'll blow your mind. I just touched a couple of her quilts over there. And it's just truly amazing how you can look at something and feel the pain. You can feel almost the thimble sticking on that hand. You can feel the needle coming through and pricks of blood coming down, like you're a diabetic or something taking insulin shots. But that's what those people felt when they were making those quilts. And they couldn't make these quilts 18, 20 hours a day. They could only make these quilts late in the afternoon before the sun went down. And before the sun went down, a group of women would come together, each one be part of this quilt. I had three piles of rags like this, and they took the rags and the cotton. They took the cotton from the fields, and they smashed the cotton down to make the batting. Now today they have synthetic battings in the quilts. These are quilts of distinction. And I'm just so honored to be able to put on such an exhibit here at the museum, telling the story about African American quilts. And there's a quilt in our back room. It's called the Underground Railroad. You'll have a chance to see it. And the quilter's back there as well who made it. It's wonderful that she tells that story. But we took the Underground Railroad and turned it into the original GPS for slaves heading north. Think about it. Now I have GPS in my pocket right now, but your forefathers are able to go from down south to Ohio into Canada by following these symbols on these quilts. It's truly, truly amazing how GPS has grown. And who started it?
We did.
Shut your mouth. It's a reversible quilt.
Oh, yeah.
Is that wonderful? She said, what side of the quilt do you want to show? I said, this one?
Yeah.
And then one person said, you ought to change it every day, you know.
Oh,
so people,
okay.
Different people come in. But just truly, in a way, she's able, these, of course, are new quilts. She's a local lady. She's from Elwood, New Jersey, right down the road over here. Hopefully she'll pop her head in there pretty soon, okay? This is Mrs. Cockfield. She's 80-some years of age, I can't really say. Now, some of the quilts are for sale. Any of the quilts you see here with a green dot on it, you can purchase. Green dot, you can purchase. All the proceeds from this particular quilt is going to go to the Newtonville Senior Society. They have an agency where they buy food from the food bank and they feed people in the area. But you like her work? And what I like about this particular work is that See, it's even on the top, but as it comes down, she got tired, or it slid off the side of the bed when she was doing it, right? So, but that's what makes a quilt a quilt. You know, it's not something that was made in a factory. It's not a cookie cutter. I don't like things that are perfectly even and perfectly symmetric. Okay, coming down the line here, you're going to see another fascinating old quilt. This particular quilt probably made in 1910, 1912. But look at the fabric and the texture. Now you can see a double bow tie. You see the double bow tie? Now the bow tie, does anyone know what that represents? The bow tie in the quilt when the slaves were coming, heading north out of Mississippi, heading to Ohio, heading to Canada. That was the path to get out. They would always have, I always wear a bow tie too.
Yes,
you do. I'm shocked today. I have a quilt on. What do you think of my quilt? So the bow tie represented, if you came to town, if you were a slave, and you came and you had all your cotton rags, all your clothes on it, they wanted you to get dressed up. So the slave master would know that you were not a runaway slave, you were probably a free slave, or had the opportunity to make it to the next level. And that symbol represents the bow tie. Look at the quilt, stand back, look at it, and you'll see thousands of things happening in these quilts. Just touching one, and you see there's patterns inside the plain pattern. I mean, it's just absolutely remarkable. Now look at a quilt, something of this nature here. Now this is made from showing off rags to riches. And look at the shape of it. See how it comes in and out, you know? I mean, they didn't have one of those curtain stretchers to hang a quilt on to get it started. They were just able to put these patterns. And you can see how some patterns came down this way and they stopped and went, oh God, we don't have any more material, Bessie. Well, what does he do with the tear? What do you? Yeah, I don't know. Check with Miss Willis. You might know what's going on over there. Miss Willis got a couple pieces of old pieces of cotton such as that. But the work and the energy and the love for their family. These quilts were made because they needed to get warm. You know, down south in the wintertime, it wasn't as hot as it was in Georgia, Alabama in the summertime. So you needed to be quilted up. They made quilts for their children. They made baby quilts, little small ones. All kinds of quilts were made in the Deep South, and they still come to work. Now, if you look to your right here, you're going to see a newer quilt. This is a fascinating quilt by another local lady from, what's her name, Betty? Alice Marks. You know Alice Marks? She's from, she's an artist. She works with oils and acrylics, so she's a fine artist. And she told me when she started quilting, she liked quilting better than fine art because it's more of a challenge. It's harder work. You have to match this piece to that piece. When you're painting on a canvas, you've got your canvas and you've got your inks and your oils. You can just go, and if it's wrong, cover it up. You can't cover this up. You had to take the whole thing apart and start over again. Ta-da! Look at the back of it.
Oh, that's nice.
So it's fall. Is that wonderful? Now you can see the detail, the embroidery that's been done inside the leaves to give the leaf more depth and dimension. So you can see it's a leaf. And the background color is just outstanding. And she brought her pumpkins down and around the outside edge. Interesting? You're going to turn a look at a quilt from my personal collection. Fell in love with this quilt many, many years ago. And it's just me, you know? I mean, it's just wonderful. And the batting, once again, that they used on a quilt like this here, they just used the cotton. You can feel how heavy it is down there. But look at the background, you know. See how the back is done? And you guys used one piece of fabric. She had to use whatever she could, all different kinds.
Yeah.
And look at the tucking inside of it. They're fabulous. Mm-hmm. Look at the stitch on the side. Look at the thickness of the thread. You had to use a heavy thread to get through to hold this heavy fabric because the cotton was heavy. Cool. Over here, you're going to see another. That's a Ken Davis piece. This is Ken Davis. This is on loan. But look what's happening here. When we hang a quilt, we hang it, you know, so it hangs flat. We don't use a rod or the tram or anything. And so gravity pulls the piece down. And once they're hanging for 2 or 3 weeks, they'll flatten out. We just got a couple in the other day that are not flattened out. We just hung them the day before yesterday. Here's your quilter who quilted this particular piece. Tell them about the piece a little bit. Why you did it?
Because I always wanted to go to Japan and put on a kimono. I just like their lifestyle a little bit. Nice and comfortable kimono. That's what it is.
Oh, that looks
nice and
comfortable.
That's good. Nice and
how long does it take to do a piece something like this?
took me months.
Months? A lot of sweat equity involved in
yeah,
making it cool.
Yeah, we
so did you do it at night? Or
no, during the day.
You did it today. You guys belong to an organization in Atlantic City called the Atlantic City Title I Quilting Society.
Yes.
And what it is a group of women who have come together, some of which are here right mm-hmm. now, and they quilt 2 days a week. They quilt every Thursday and every Friday. And I know this for a fact. I've been over there fussing with them women. Oh, Lord. Whew. You like to have 10 women to fuss with about a quilt? Man, oh, man. When I went there, I had my hair was black. And I was 6'4". They beat me down. Just, but absolutely incredible. We're just delighted to have their organization here representing the 101 quilts that we have here. We thought we were going to have 101. We ended up with 108.
Yeah, that's Selma's bag here. Trying to look at this piece. This is Miss Archibald. Archibald has put this piece together. Now, you would think she did this out of all scraps and things that had no real meaning. But if you look at this quote and see the definition and the detail, not only on the front, but on the back as well. So it would come, as we would say in the old days, it was reversible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, both of you, yeah.
And over here we have Agnes, who's been the, yeah. she was the instructor who brought these ladies together, this quilting guild. She's part of the Title I program. Agnes Galway, you can talk into the camera and say whatever you want to say about your quilts or your ladies who put this quilting exhibit together.
Oh, good afternoon. I have a fabulous group of ladies in Atlantic City, and we're one big happy family. We meet every Tuesday and Thursday from 4 to 8 and make quilts. I retired in 2003, got drafted to work with the Parent Center, and then someone said, why don't you teach them how to make quilts? Because I was taking courses. And a lot of these ladies said they went home and they didn't do anything. But after I started the quilt class, they won't let me go. I'm trying to quit. And they said, no, I can have a vacation, but I can't quit. But I have lovely, lovely ladies, and some of them, they design their own. And it's whatever you feel, you know, you can put together as a quilt. And they will continue on. As I said, I'm trying to run away, and they won't let me.
No.
And some of your quilters are here. Your name, please?
Joanne.
Joanne, what?
Lyons.
Okay.
Pat Tweedle. Francina Kayson. Karen Webb.
Okay, that's fantastic. And Karen's the one who made the table runner
right
over
there. Okay.
All right, we're going to come on down and continue. This here is also a piece done by Archibald. I want you to take a look at this piece over here. You can really appreciate the Sumerian piece, but the squares, you can almost see a window and a table.
Yeah.
You can see what's happening in these squares. It's a square and a square inside of an L. But matching these colors are just, ta-da, look at that.
Oh, look at that.
This is quilting as quilting should be. Now, we have quilters who've been quilting for 7-8 years. Then we have quilters hung on the wall who are quilting as little girls, you know, back at the turn of the century. And then we have a thing called a master quilter. And master quilters are such people who have been doing it for many years as Ms. Archibald. So you can appreciate, they look like a bunch of rags, but if you look at those, cutting each one of those pieces of fabric and then putting it together is a nightmare. I would never attempt it. I'd rather, I wouldn't do that to anyone. Well, anyhow, just fabulous. So these are two Archibald quilts. You're going to turn and look at a quilt over here. This is probably the oldest quilt we have in our exhibit. This quilt's on loan to us from a lady in Philadelphia by the name of Carol Harper. Carol Harper's aunt, who was from Pennsylvania, a descendant of slaves. You can feel, I've been to Africa, and I've been in the belly of the ship, and I've been in Gori Castle, and I felt my ancestors. When I saw this quilt coming in, it took me right back to where I came from. My parents in Mississippi, their grandparents. You can just feel them sitting out on that porch, just putting these together for 2-3 hours a day. It's just truly, truly. But the patterns are wonderful. Wonderful. This is not an Underground Railroad quilt like we'll be seeing a little later on, but just a wonderful piece of fabric. And once again, look at the shape. Truly outstanding. You're going to see another old quilt. Take a look at this one here. And I want you to touch and feel the weight of it. I've got one of these got a bunch of cotton in the bottom of it.
Well, different parts, because the cotton that they used was, you had to mash it down. You had to mash it down. But the pattern is just incredible. Whatever they had, they used. I mean, you can see a piece of fabric in this quilt here is in that there oblong quilt down over there. It was made by the same lady from down in Bridgeton, New Jersey. Of course, my favorite quilt in the whole exhibit is probably this one here. And I'll tell you why. Back at the point in time when quilts were being quilted by quilters, they had lots of fabric to work with. They had colors and all. But where in the world did this quilter get pink material from almost 100 years ago? Unheard of. What could it have been? Dyed it? I don't think they had the capability of dyeing. I mean, if they got it. Huh? The berry?
Yeah, the berry.
But look at the shading. Look at the shading and the pinks there and so forth. Just incredible to have done something with pink. But look at the quilt a little deeper and you'll see something else. I want you to look at here. Psst. What'd you just see? Psst. Okay. But see, she did the whole piece here. She did 2, 4, 6, 8, 12. She had. These are imaginary.
Okay.
See that? Yeah. And she fooled me. I looked at this quilt and I fell in love with these two spots. And every time a newspaper reporter would come in or a TV guy, I'd talk about this quilt. And a reporter came in the other day. He says, "Mr. Hunter, you missed the one at the bottom."
Yeah.
See that? Mm-hmm. One at the bottom. And you know, a lot of quilters in the old age, what they would do, they would sign their quilts with a piece of fabric. And they used the same color fabric on every quilt that they made. So you knew that was Miss Elma's quilt. You know that was Mom Lee's quilt. Who made that quilt? Did no signature, just that one piece of tacking in the lower right-hand corner. I found it on one quilt in the past 10 years. But incredible. Down this here hallway here, you're going to see some also amazing quilts. The quilts you're going to find down there is the AKA quilt. And there's some spiritual and instrumental pieces down there. They talk about, after the tour, you can come back and take the time and read some of the sayings and the quotations that are on some of those quilts up and down that aisle. I want you guys to take a look at this piece of art. Take two steps back, okay? Now, tell me what you see. Raise your hand, tell me what you see. Does anybody see boxes opening up? You don't see any boxes opening up? You do? See what's happening? You see boxes that are closed? What does it look like to you? Take this glass and you have this round thing, you turn it around. Kaleidoscope, right?
Yeah.
Okay. This you can see. Now if you can see the end of the boxes, this is the square of the box and it goes back that way. This is one here and it comes this way. See what it's just not a pinwheel or a star or any other things they call. It's a form of art that's truly, truly amazing. Because art is what you depict in the art. I'm a guy who believes that get a piece of art, look at it for 4 or 5 days, and keep tearing it apart in my head. And I can find things that the artist is trying to say to you that he can't really say, but you have to find it in his work. All great artists hide something in their work. It's there. It's truly, truly there. Okay? Great piece. Now this piece over here, tell us about this one here, if you would, please.
My sampler. This is just different examples of blocks that quilters use, and these are just ones that I picked to use to put in this quilt. I'm trying to just get a lot of different colors together, and the leaf and the bird. The way I arranged it. Some of the colors, the darker reds at the top, and then the other reds and the blue in the center, and then the blues at the bottom, and the oranges on either side, and the pink and purple in the middle. So,
what's the back?
The back is this.
Mm-hmm. Now, does someone look at this here? When we talked about looking at a piece of art or looking at a quilt, what is happening? This is not a one-dimensional quilt. This is almost a two-dimensional quilt because inside of the bird, it's matted, and the bird looks like he's in flight. You're starting to feel that? And if you see the same thing down in here, these are stuffed so that they stand out, they jump out.
She hides things in her art, and I think all you ladies do.
I told her I was an artist. And I picked a piece up, and I picked the second piece, and she said, stop. And I thought, oh, that's not the response I was trying to get. And she said, no, wait a minute. And she actually ran to the phone and called Mr. Hunter and put him on speaker. And I thought, what if he said, you must be out of your mind.
You knew. I knew. And he knew if I'm referring that they have to be.
She really felt that. She really did that. She really did that. She put him on speaker. So you got to have her.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank both of you.
This is a wonderful. This piece is done by Muriel Greenwich. Once again, I told you how to look at a piece of art and make something happen in your head. They're not colors, it's not fabulous. In fabric, you can see a flower, you can see a kaleidoscope moving. It's moving as you're looking at it. I mean, just look at the depth. Oh, another one of my artists just came in. Oh, you're gonna see her work next. And that's hers. If you look at this piece and look at this piece, what's the difference between that and this? Can you tell me? Nothing. It's the exact same piece, just different fabrics used. Exact same piece. Now look at this and look at that, right? But if you have to look and focus at the art and understand it, it's just truly incredible. You see it? Incredible?
In Ghana and in Nigeria, there is a ceremony, there's a parade, and most people think it's about the costume, but it's really about the drumming. But the drummers, they complement each other. I did an artistic take on this Yoruba masquerade costume because normally it would cover the wearer, which is usually a man. It would cover him all over. And oh, many, many years ago, I was in West Africa and I stepped out of the hotel and there were people everywhere. And when I pushed my way through the crowd, there was this masquerade going on, something similar to what we have at Mardi Gras. And this man was swirling and he had on all of these pieces and I thought no more about it. I really did not. And about 6 months ago, I went to our Museum of Art in Raleigh, North Carolina, and they have acquired a real Yoruba masquerade costume. And I was so taken, I was absolutely taken with it, that I came home and this is the way I interpreted these pieces. And I incorporated handmade paper, paper beads, handmade ceramic beads, buttons, shells, and all of the things that are traditionally used in African art, especially in their folk art. They use a lot of buttons, a lot of paper, and found objects. We, in the 60s, we started to call found objects assemblage or assemblage. But in Africa, they've been using found objects in their art since the beginning of time. They really have, because they tend to use what they have and what's near to them. So these are Yoruba masquerades, costumes.
If you look at a piece such as this, see that patch here? That's called the Drunkard's Path. So when the slaves are leaving Mississippi, going to Ohio, heading towards Canada, they would head north, right? You wouldn't head back down south, you wouldn't go east or west, because you went towards Mississippi. So the Drunkard's Path walks like this here. You would run this way for about one day, and one day you come back and go west, another day you go east, and then you go south. So when the hound dogs were following you, they couldn't follow you, your sin. So that's the creation of the Drunkard's Path. And just one of the quilts. Now we have the quilter here today who did this piece. Where is she?
Right here.
Can you come up here a second, please?
Come on.
I need you. And you want to hear the beautiful part about this here? If we had to sell this quilt, it would probably sell in the neighborhood of $2,500. She came here yesterday and she came to the museum for the very first time. And she said what to me?
It's yours.
She donated the quilt to the museum. Hallelujah.
Right.
Is that incredible? Incredible. Before, it wasn't for sale. It doesn't have a green tag on it, so it wasn't for sale. Now the museum can take this quilt around to all the different schools and churches, and we love to come to your school, to your township, or wherever you live, to bring our traveling museum. Tell us some more about it. You want me to do it? Reverend White, I told you. Reverend White. Reverend White. This is my trusted assistant, my right-hand man. He knows more about this museum than everyone. This is Reverend Milton White, and when I'm absent, which is most of the time, he fills in. And when he's not filling in, Diane fills in. One of us fills in. Reverend White, I told him about the drunken path. Will you take it from there? I got something to do here.
Okay. Great. Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming and supporting the African American Heritage Museum of Southern New Jersey. Thank you for supporting the quilters that came out. Those who have their work for sale, please, if you can, purchase their quilts, layaway or whichever way. And I don't know why he asked me to do this when there are so many quilters here who could do a better job. The importance, when they first said they were going to do a exhibit on quilts, my first thing was, my God, I think building blocks would be more excited other than quilts. And then I began to understand that the different quilters came in and spoke about the importance of the quilts during the Underground Railroad. It was quite exciting. As I started learning about the different patterns, I was just blown away. The ingenuity of the slaves. Here, when you look at it, they were not allowed to read or to write. And that was supposed to stop them from escaping and communicating with one another. Yet, they found an ingenious way to still read and write and communicate with each other. And it was through the quilts. And as you well know, during the day or during the evening, you would see just that little old slave woman sitting there doing patchwork in open view of the slave owners or the plantation owners, never realizing that what she was doing was communicating with other people and telling the story of how they were going to escape. When I looked at the pattern of the Jacob's ladder, and it was told that the way the path to escape was the way that this angle was leaning towards that particular passage. So that was an ingenious way. And they, if it was hung on a line or hung outside, then that showed an ingenious way for them how to escape. I particularly love the monkey wrench, which was usually the blacksmith. And it's exciting because the blacksmith was those who, on one hand, created the chains, took from place to enslave slaves, yet he also carried that information to let them know to carry the tools, prepare your tools, and be ready to escape. So prepare not just the physical tools for your job, but also carry your provisions. Make sure that you are mentally prepared, because this was going to be a hard trip, not something that you can start off and say, you know what, this escape from slavery is too much for me. But make sure emotionally and spiritually that you are prepared to take this journey. And of course, they know, you know about the wagon wheel again. Why am I doing it? Because preparing to go, the time is now to escape into that trek away from slavery. Also, and I particularly love the one of Mr. Hunter's favorite pieces that he loved to wear, his bow tie. And whenever you saw the bow tie, what was exciting about that is whenever you came to that location and you saw a quilt like that, then that let you know that was the time that you removed those slave clothing and you dressed in the attire of someone of a higher class. So if you ran across a slave hunter, they wouldn't think that you were a slave. And of course, the next pattern you see is that of a shoe fly. Now the shoe fly is interesting in itself because they were called conductors, as you know. And a conductor is someone that runs the train, and we would be the passengers, all of us who was part of the Underground Railroad. And they were somebody that you can trust, and they were someone who would lead you to safety. And that safe place would be the safe houses. And that was the purpose, as you know, with the log cabins and so forth. But what was exciting was the block inside that particular patchwork. If it was red, then that would let you know that that was an okay safe house. If it was yellow, it would be similar to what we talk about with the jack-o'-lantern. If it was yellow, then that means you would have to watch that lantern, because if it was lit, then that means it was a time for you could come in and get something to eat and move on to the next safe house, which was probably only about 14 to 20 miles away. If it was out, then that meant that was not a good time to come in and get something, because you were being, that place was being watched. If it was black like it is, then that would let you know it's probably okay for you to dig in for the winter, probably even change your name and start your life anew. Okay? So it was pieces like that, and of course, I'm just going through a few of them. The geese, when you see the pattern of the geese, you know that was the time that you would pack up and you would be ready and follow the track of the geese, because it would lead you to what was the locations, most of all, most slaves went to, was Cleveland, Ohio, which had the path that went directly up into Canada. Now, he already told you the story. Well, first, I also have to tell you about the basket, which showed the also, like the tools, have your provisions ready, because when you left, make sure not just the food, but you had clothing, because you did have to have the clothing, like the bow tie, like the pants. You had to have your attire, so when you came into that situation that you can change. And he told you about the drunken path. And also, when you see this, you will see the boat. The boat, where there's a boat, then you know there is water. So that would also let you know that the water and provisions, food was nearby. So this was just some of the few pieces. Another one of my favorites, I have to say this before I leave, was the bear claw. And I find this amusing, because when you saw that, a quilt made of that, that lets you know that you can follow the path of the bear and it will lead you to food and water. And my thing is, don't follow too closely, because you did not want to be the meal of the bear.
Now, when you look at a setting such as this, you'll see a beautiful piece over here done by Muriel Greenwich. This piece in the back over here is done by a senior citizen from Newtonville. Her name is Cotwell. And she put together that quilt in less than 9 months. Can you imagine sewing that by hand, less than 9 months? Just incredible. If you look at the bed, of course, that's the Texas Star, right? But a lot of people think of the Texas Star as not the Texas Star, but as the North Star. And the North Star had a lot to do with runaway slaves heading north. I guess you guys have done your history and you know exactly what happened, how the slaves got out of Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi. They headed north, and they headed through Ohio. There's one piece over there on that quilt over there where all the red diamonds. That's a town in Ohio where there were a lot of conductors who were able to bring the slaves into Canada. A lot went to Canada. So to me, that's not the Texas Star, that's the North Star.